On Hot Copy this morning, netizens questioned the amount of the refunds they got from ride-hailing firm Grab. Grab started distributing refunds worth 19 million pesos to passengers on Tuesday, as ordered by the Philippine Competition Commission, for overcharging riders. Netizens pointed out how they were refunded 17 pesos despite spending up to 500 pesos per ride. Passengers are supposed to receive 1 peso for every 1,200 pesos spent between February to May, and 1 peso for every 450 pesos spent between May and August. Other users made sarcastic remarks, like this user who's thanking Grab for her 1 peso refund. All right, joining us on Hot Copy this morning to start 2020 is Grab Philippines head Brian Ku. Welcome to Hot Copy, Brian. Thank you. Well, it seems you're not getting real thank yous.
Yes.
But have you refunded all of the 19 million already?
Well, first of all, Happy New Year to you, Karen.
Happy New Year.
To everyone watching. Yes, the refund of the 19 million pesos has been disbursed into the GrabPay wallet. So users just have to open the app, go to the inbox, click on one of those messages where they've received the refund vouchers, and click redeem, and that money would go into the GrabPay wallet voucher, which they can use for either a food order or a ride order.
No, so just for the record, at the start of 2020, you have already completed the 19 million pesos refund.
So that 19 million pesos was actually a fine given by the PCC, but they decided that instead of them collecting the fine, they asked us to pay it to the users.
Yeah.
So that was in total 19 million pesos
Because let's explain, the third quarter you were fined 5 million.
Correct.
And then the fourth quarter you were fined 14.15 million.
Correct. So these are for deviations in pricing. So we've established that there was no overcharging. Even the LTFRB, when we spoke with them and showed them our pricing over those periods, said there was no overcharging that happened. We were well within the range of the LTFRB fare matrix.
But why would you have been fined if you were well within the range?
There are two ranges that we had to follow. So this is the difficulty in the situation that we're in. LTFRB.
So to say overcharging, you feel is unfair.
Yes.
Because when you read all the articles,
they all say
all news articles say overcharging.
Correct. These are pricing deviations. Even the PCC, when they came out with the order of the fines, mentioned pricing deviations and not overcharging. So the difference between overcharging and pricing deviation would be, overcharging is when we would exceed the recommended or the required fare matrix of the LTFRB. Now, the PCC had a range within that range, so it's a smaller range. So we deviated against those commitments.
Okay.
Hence the fine.
But the commitments were voluntary, I mean, with Grab, right?
Yes, the commitments were voluntary on our part, but we assumed certain conditions in the market to come to pass, which did not. For example, an increase in the number of cars, which would help reduce the surge. Also, the worsening traffic conditions, which we didn't expect, increased the time element of the fare, which then increased the final fare.
Okay, all right. So the 19 million you've already, if you don't want to say the word refund, what word would you want to say?
I guess we paid it back.
So the 19 million, you've refunded it already, but instead of getting thank yous, I mean, Grab writers are quite sarcastic online.
They are.
By
saying,
thank you so much for putting in the 1 peso in my Grab wallet. Yeah. Explain the system of how you've refunded it. We did explain that you were refunding, 1 peso for every 450, 1 peso for every 1,200. But you do have writers that got 17 pesos, some that got 2 pesos.
Yes.
So how did you calculate the refund?
So it's based on the amount spent that they had, just as you explained, the amount spent they had during the periods that you mentioned, from February to August. Now, if you take 19 million pesos against the monthly active users of the platform, which is around 3 million, so on average, it would be really around 20 pesos per user. So I, for one, since I use it a lot, I got
only if they use it equally, right?
If they all use it equally, correct. Then you have some users that use it maybe once a week, some users use it maybe once a month. So those are the users that may have gotten the 1 peso, 2 peso refund.
Okay. Were they expecting, you feel, another way to refund?
I honestly don't know what they were expecting, but if you do the math on it, the average wouldn't go beyond 20 pesos.
Okay. The largest the largest refund you gave to a rider would be, have you seen it? Was it 17 or did rider reach 20?
It would definitely be more. So I for one, I'm a pretty heavy user of the service, and I got 50 pesos.
Okay.
Total.
Okay.
Yeah. So there would be users that would use it more heavily than I would. So it could go up to 70, 80, 90 pesos.
Okay. But I think you need to explain, because they may think, I mean, clearly it's only used once, you can only actually take advantage of it by using Grab again.
Well, technically...
because it goes into the wallet.
It goes into the wallet, but our wallet is now an open wallet. Mm-hmm. We have a license from the BSP for the Grab wallet.
Okay.
And if they're fully KYC'd, so they went through the whole application process, they can take the money in the wallet and move it to their BDO account, for example.
So they can use it as cash?
They can use it as cash. Or they can go to a Starbucks
and buy
a cup of coffee, because we accept the wallet there in locations like that, or an SM supermarket.
Okay, but that's only, of course, I mean, a Starbucks cup would at least be $100.
Yeah. They'd have either to load up the wallet or to use the other discounts that are available inside that.
How does this affect Grab as a business? I mean, I understand what you mean, because you're right, riders don't seem to understand the understanding and what you call extended understanding, which are voluntary commitments in regulating pricing, right?
Yes.
So you have a window with the Philippine
Competition Commission.
Competition Commission, and yet there's a bigger window technically with the LTFRB.
Correct.
And you went above the PCC window.
That's right.
But if the PCC keeps fining Grab, how will this affect the business in the long term, given that Uber has closed in many countries already? Uber has not made money on many countries.
Yep. So it certainly dampened our 2019 holiday season. It had a big impact on the financials, but we're taking it all as an expense with the company and not passing it on to consumers or drivers.
Yeah.
Now we've reset the commitment to the PCC after the four quarters of the first set of voluntary commitments.
Right. What are your new commitments?
So the new commitments around pricing, instead of a fare in range, which is what they used to call it, we're now looking at the average fare. So it's an easier way to track and monitor the fares. And we believe that with this new method of measuring the fares, we wouldn't be in violation anymore. So we're looking at 2020 to past 2020 without any violations.
But what happened in 2019? What made you violate? In other words, if I'm getting a Grab, there was a period in time that if you got a Grab during the Christmas season, let's say from Makati to Quezon City, you were paying an insane amount of, let's say, 300 pesos one way.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
What changed in the calculation during certain periods?
Yeah. So during December, there was an influx of passengers.
Yeah.
So there were around 5 million
Grab users.
People trying to book in a single day.
A single day.
In a single day, 5 million.
Because you were a supply and demand.
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct. And that went up from, let's say, 2 million before the Christmas period. So at our number of cars stayed flat at 35, 36,000 cars daily active. So given that, with that higher number of people booking, the surge went up. That was one.
So how do you do the math there? I think that's what riders need to understand. Okay. So there are 30,000 cars out there.
Yes.
And then what happens if a million more people start going on the app? How does the app do the math that the prices increase?
Sure. If the app sees that there's more supply, there's more
demand
than there is supply, surge will start kicking in. In pricing. So there's a 2x cap on the surge. So whereas before, it was surging maybe at 1.5, 1.6. When there's a big demand-supply imbalance, surge would kick up to 2x. So that was the first thing that happened.
And 2x would change how much for a rider?
It would pretty much double the price.
Double the price, rider. Okay.
The other thing that happened here was the traffic. So before going Makati to QC, it may take an hour. During Christmas, it took 2 hours.
Yeah.
So the time it took doubled.
Yeah.
So there was a doubling of the time and a doubling of that time component. So yeah. In effect, sometimes the price says went up more than 2x.
But is the Grab algorithm, is this a universally accepted algorithm in
yes.
pricing? In other words, this is not something that Grab manipulates
oh, no.
manually at a point in time when it wants to?
No. We cannot manipulate
okay.
that. Number one, we cannot manipulate that. And number two, actually, the regulations in other markets are more relaxed. There's no cap and surge in other markets. And there's no regulations around pricing in other markets.
Mm-hmm.
So here in the Philippines, we need to price it at 15 pesos per kilometer and 2 pesos per minute. The range disappeared. Before, we were pricing it at 12 pesos to 15 pesos at a certain range.
Yeah.
Now, the way the LTFRB structured pricing, it's now fixed at 15 pesos. So we're unable to bring that down even if we wanted to.
Really?
Because we'll be okay. in violation.
So is this the 2020 commitment now? Because you said you have new commitments coming in. So what have you agreed to? Is it at 15 pesos per kilometer?
That's with the LTFRB. So that stays fixed as 15 pesos.
Okay. But then with the PCC, what are the new commitments? So you won't be fined again.
With the PCC, there's an average fare every month. So that differs every month. So I think for January, it's around 280, 290, 290 pesos on average. So they look at certain routes, certain times of day. And the fare, the average fare within those routes and those days should stay within the 290, 300 peso range.
Yeah. What would be the reason why it would, excuse me, go beyond 290?
Again, traffic mm-hmm. is a big reason. Surge is another big reason. But we expect demand to drop this January, so
okay.
we feel that we would.
Now, you were also fined an additional 2 million pesos because of... drivers canceling
correct.
Yes, I mean orders. Technically,
yes. canceling bookings.
Bookings
yeah.
is the right term. The question is, why do drivers do that, and how do you penalize them, and why is it allowed? Because I know many people in ABS alone
yeah.
that book, they're waiting, and then suddenly
the driver
cancels.
Correct.
So ideally, once you accept, you shouldn't cancel.
Exactly. Now, the reason why the cancellation button is there is for unforeseen circumstances.
Correct? Like what?
Flatan or
okay.
It's really impossible for the driver to get there. But
okay.
again, other than those, there's no reason for the driver to cancel.
Mm-mm.
Now, what happens if he cancels is that he gets a negative rating
Mm-mm.
in the app. If he cancels consistently, he gets suspended. And then, once he gets back and does it again, he'll eventually get banned from the platform.
Okay, but do you ever ask the drivers why they cancel?
Yes, we do. So when they cancel, there's a list of reasons in the app the driver can put down. We'll verify some of those reasons. Let's say if the driver says the passenger wasn't there or the passenger didn't show up, that's a valid reason
yeah.
for him to cancel, right? We'll verify it with the passenger and see if the passenger really was not able to come down and take the trip.
Do you ever ban drivers?
Oh yeah, we do.
Okay,
every
how
week
many
we,
have
we
you?
Ban drivers.
I'm curious.
We've banned, I think, in the thousands of drivers already
okay.
for various reasons, right? So cancellation is one of those reasons. Another one would be not accepting trips. If they don't accept, if it shows up and they ignore, they eventually get banned if they do it in excess.
And you're able to see that, of course.
Yeah, we track all the metrics. Yes.
Okay, and then canceling trips, ignoring bookings.
Ignoring bookings. You know, if there's any untoward incident against the passenger,
okay.
we'll of course hear both sides. But then, if we deem that the driver is guilty, he also gets banned from the platform.
Okay, because I mean that's a 2 million peso fine.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you did give it to PCC, but you'd want to avoid an extra expense for the company like that for 2020.
Yes, we would. But if we become more stringent with our drivers in a whole, you're affecting a lot of the good drivers, right? So you want to avoid type 1, type 2 errors.
Oh.
So we're trying to
But how do
focus.
You lower the percentage of drivers that are actually... canceling? Because I think you have, do you have a 5% limit?
Around that, yeah.
You have a 5% limit for cancellations, and you've exceeded it to something like 12.
Yes.
Okay.
So first is education. So we need to re-educate a lot of the drivers. Two is a lot of the revenues being generated is being placed back into the platform to improve the mapping algorithm. So it allows you to find drivers that are really nearby. Because some of the reasons for cancel is the driver that you get assigned are on the other side of the road.
Yeah.
Tas iikot pa. Then it takes 30 minutes for that U-turn.
Right.
Then the driver's like, I know, I don't.
So ideally, if it's the, if that's the case, it's the other side of the road, would you encourage the driver and the booker, the rider to speak for the rider to cross the road?
Yes. So,
okay.
So,
it allow something
correct.
Like that.
So we're creating different features in the app that would then request the rider to say, if you cross the road, you can get a 10 peso discount and meet the driver on the other side of the road. But there are some passengers that, you know, I booked here, pick me up here. I don't care if it takes you an hour to make that U-turn. So a bit of understanding from passengers, given the situation we have on the roads, would also go a long way.
Okay. For 2020, will there be more drivers, more cars? So you have, you're 30,000 strong now?
Around 35, yes.
35,000. Yes.
So we do hope that the LTFRB opens up new slots. The root of these issues are in the lack of supply.
Okay.
So just imagine, you know, the 5 million bookings a day during rush hour, you know, that spikes.
Yeah.
If we don't have more supply or different modes of supply, and if they can't get public transport going, this is the only means of a lot of our kababayans to commute.
Okay. I'm curious, with all the fines that you had to pay, I mean, because first quarter you were asked 11.3 million, second quarter 7.1, then 5 million, then 14. So all
in
all,
a total of 40 million.
Yeah, you paid a total of 40 million for 2019.
Yes.
What was the net income of Grab for 2019? What's your estimate?
Well, we haven't closed the books yet, but we pretty much barely broke even last year.
Yeah, yeah.
So we're still in investment mode. So it's part, whole part of the plan for us to really put a lot of the savings that we got back into the technology,
because
back into the platform.
The perception, if you're a rider, is ang yaman-yaman ng Grab. You know, when you're riding, ang mahal-mahal ng Grab, ang yaman-yaman. But there's a calculation of how much goes to the driver and how much goes to the company.
Thank you for that.
Because that's why netizens are angry. They think everything goes to Grab.
Yes. Well, driving a car is not free. So just based on the fares, around 85% goes to the driver.
So let's pick a fare.
Let's say 500.
500 pesos.
So 85%, so what's that? 425 pesos would go to the driver.
Yeah. You know?
If that trip took an hour, that means he made 500 pesos. He made 425 pesos for that hour. He works 10 hours a day. He makes 4,250 pesos in gross total bookings. He pays gas of 1,200.
Yeah.
Aket gas this month. So it's going to go up. So 1,200. He gets left with 3,000. 3,000, he pays the amortization
of his car.
For the car, around 1,000. Put aside another 500 for maintenance and servicing. So he gets left with 1,000, 1,500 for working 10 to 12 hours.
Yeah.
Kasi may idle time yun.
Yes,
so 10 hours is not 10 trips a month. 12 hours, he makes 1,000, 1,200. So a lot of our drivers have actually increased income from minimum wage, are now earning twice minimum wage. So by people saying you're overcharging, you're making too much, or it's like saying the driver is making too much. Is it wrong for a driver to go from minimum wage to a bit higher, and now he's able to put his kids to school? It's really for the future also.
Because the calculation, is it a strict, because you will be called to the lower house.
And even the Senate.
I know, because the House is set to investigate Grab. So 85% of the charge goes to the driver.
Yes.
Is that fair?
Yes, around.
15% will go to Grab, the company.
Correct. We charge 20, but then around 5 to 7% of that goes back in incentives and rebates to the driver. So net, around 15% comes to us.
What if you're asked in the lower house, can you do with less as a company?
Honestly, we can't, because it's not... We're one of the largest consumers of Amazon Web Services. We pay millions and millions of dollars to Amazon on a monthly basis. So people think that just because you're operating on an app, that means you know, they don't see the costs, but the costs are real. And they're in the millions of dollars because a lot of the providers of these services are based abroad and they don't charge, you know, they don't charge cheap.
Yeah. Okay. Now, what's your reaction to the rise of popularity of the motorcycle ride hailing app Angkas? Okay. Its success is based on lower fares compared to Grab, and it takes advantage of motorcycles because they weave in through traffic. Sure. So what do you think of Angkas?
So I think in markets like this, same with other Southeast Asian markets, there are different modes of transport to cater to different types of uses. So if you're in a hurry, you don't have that much of a budget to take a car, you take a motorcycle taxi, which is what users do in the other markets where we have motorcycle taxis.
Okay, so like Vietnam?
Like Vietnam, like Indonesia, like Thailand. So it serves a different need, no? But if you consider how much a motorcycle taxi would cost versus a car would cost, a car can fit four people.
Yeah.
If you divide the cost of the car by four and you share with some friends, it's cheaper than that single ride of a motorcycle.
Yeah. Actually, that's a good point because what they're calculating is one person who rides a Grab car and one person who rides Angkas.
Correct.
But you're saying that's not the logic. You can fit four.
Correct. If Angkas is half the price of Grab, for me, that's expensive because I can take a Grab and share it with three other people.
Yeah, but then the problem with Manila, as you know this, is I think 90% of the cars in EDSA, as MMDA said, is really one passenger.
Correct.
Right?
So there was a pitch that we made to the LTFRB before where we were asking them to provisionally accredit carpooling as a service.
For Grab?
For not just for Grab, for any other TNC that wants to get into
it.
And the whole idea there was to alleviate the whole congestion of people trying to get into MRT by allowing users who are traversing EDSA anyway to take a passenger and share the cost of the gas of the car just during that 7 kilometer stretch.
Yeah, that
and that would
good.
Help. That will not lessen traffic, but it will help a lot more people move from one end to the other.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, and so far, what did LTFRB say?
Hearing public
sites. Okay, but is carpooling for Grab popular?
It was in Singapore. We never was we were never able to.
You never piloted it here.
Yeah, because we would be in violation of the law. So unless there was regulations around it.
Yeah. Okay, but do you believe Angkas should stay?
I believe that motorcycle taxis should stay. In fact, we're also looking at that sector. If the regulations are now put in place, we believe it's something that's worth looking at.
Yeah. You know what's interesting is in other Southeast Asian countries, motorcycle hailing apps are used, but they're not on the main thoroughfare.
Mm.
They're like either on the side street.
Yeah.
What's scary in Manila is they're right smack in the middle of EDSA.
Yes. That's a MMDA.
Yeah. Is there a better way to do it?
Definitely.
I think it would be safer if they were in roads.
I agree. And the way to do it is through technology. So technology can restrict where people can book, where the routes, where the recommended routes are. Because if there's no technology, if it's pure habal-habal, no insurance, no technology, bahala sila. They can pick up and drop off anywhere. But if there was a technology layer on top of it, the regulators can then work with that technology layer to restrict the pickup drop-off points, to restrict where they move, because they'll see the route there.
Yeah.
So yes, there's a better way to do it, and the only way to do it is via technology.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else you'd like to add? You are preparing for the hearings. What is the biggest misconception? We spoke about it a bit in terms of just how much goes to Grab. But the biggest misconception that lawmakers may have and consumers may have.
Well, I guess the whole idea of overcharging, you know, I want to get that word out of the vocabulary
when you're in a hearing.
About, correct. Yeah. Because we are not overcharging, even the LTFRB said.
But how much more expensive are you than a taxi cab?
Sometimes we're cheaper. If the supply demand, you know, there's no imbalance, but during rush hour will be definitely a bit more expensive.
Yeah.
But that's also why the service that we provide is better. Not us, but the drivers provide.
So
is
when
better.
The hearing comes, you will stand and say that you can't be priced like a taxi.
Oh, we definitely cannot be priced like it. I think taxi pricing is archaic. It's very old. Even in Singapore, normal taxi pricing, which is even more advanced because they have rush hour pricing, they have CBD pricing, they have fuel surcharge pricing, and depends on where you get picked up, the pricing is different. There's some form of dynamic pricing already, but the meters that our taxis use now are analog. We're in the digital world. Why not use a digital meter that takes into conditions of the environment around you, supply demand factors, and to help taxi operators make an extra income to upgrade their vehicles, so they don't run their vehicles full 13 years and people don't want to ride it and in it anymore.
Why is it difficult to book a grab car that's an upper scale, let's say, usually, right, it's called Grab X.
The Grab Premium.
Yes, Grab Premium. Mostly, many say that, Karen, when you book a Grab, an Innova will come. Well, there's nothing wrong with that, except clearly you do have riders that want, an SUV or a Camry, like in other countries.
So the economics don't work.
Not here.
As simple as that. So the way we're allowed to price, you can only afford a Fortuner. That's the maximum, a 1.7 million peso car. If you're allowed to price a bit higher, then we can start introducing the Camrys, I think a 2 million peso and above vehicle.
Yeah.
But then there's a question of demand. Would there be enough demand?
Maybe not enough, but maybe for some evenings you would. And people want to go on dates, I don't know.
Sure, definitely. But then the car will not be able to make money, or the driver will not be able to make money for it to be able to sustain in a longer period.
Unlike, let's say, I agree with you, so it's market-driven.
It's market-driven.
Unlike if you're in New York.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, people, a lot of them are like premium Ubers, right?
Yes,
yeah. Okay.
They have Suburbans and what have you.
Then. Yeah. So the highest end you have is a Fortuner.
I've seen some Volkswagens on the platform.
Oh, that's nice.
I've seen, Everest, Fortuners.
But, to be fair, the Innova is the most practical to use.
Oh, yes. It's a seven-seater. The high-end Innova is super comfortable.
And because the gas.
Yes.
I mean, matipid siya. And that's a factor. All right, last words. So you're set to, in the lower house, it's Congressman Castelo. It's, he filed the resolution to look into the Grab pricing. When are you preparing for that? Did you already?
We've sent them letters already. Even Senator Gatchalian, we sent in the same letter that we sent the LTFRB, showing how we priced certain trips, giving them a sample of trips.
Yeah.
They're free to send us a sample of trips that they've took also. We passed LTFRB, so we're confident that we have nothing to hide and we'll be able to get through the.
What would you like to explain to the netizens? Speak to them now. Clearly it's the netizens that are, a lack of understanding of how the business goes gets them wild online.
Yeah, well, firstly, I'd like them to understand that pricing is, a large part of it's based on supply and demand. So, we shouldn't, I hope they don't keep blaming Grab for the lack of it. We should work with the government, with the netizens, with the riding public, and with the government to hopefully increase that supply base and allow more cars to come in on the platform, because it's really doing a service to the community. So it's not us versus them or us versus the driver. We're really trying to just work together for a better transport future for the country.
All right. And the refunds are over.
The refunds are over. So everyone who hasn't opened the app yet, please do. Go to your inbox and click on the refund message there and just redeem your refund.
On that note, Brian, thank you
Karen.
So much for coming to Head Start, and happy 2020 to you.
Happy 2020 to you too.
All right, we're going to take a quick break. Head Start, we'll be right back.